experience of being betrayed, of having someone break a promise or cheat on you, of having someone abandon you in your time of need. Maybe it was a family member or a close friend, a work colleague or a teacher. It could have been a spouse who had an affair or a favorite student who cheated on a test. It could have been a parent who didn't show up or a friend who lied. It could have been a business partner who was stealing company funds or a colleague who took the credit for your work. There are so many ways to betray our relationships with others. If you've had some of these experiences, then you know how much betrayal hurts. It breaks our trust and makes it harder to trust again. It makes us angry, confused, sad. And the stronger the relationship or covenant we have with the person, the more it hurts and the harder it is to recover. I'm guessing that most of us have had the experience of being betrayed, and that many of us have also had the experience of betraying someone else. Whether it's a formal covenant, like the vows taken in marriage or holy orders, or an informal one, like the relationships between friends or colleagues, the breaking of promises or commitments is painful all the way around. Ultimately, the breaking of a covenant is what our passage from Hosea is about. God's covenant with the people of Israel. God's promise of steadfast love to God's people and the people's promise of faithfulness to God. A promise that the people of Israel break again and again and again. Now I realize that the imagery used in this passage from Hosea is hard to hear. Especially on a hot summer day in July, in a polite, lovely place like Bruton Parish. Jan complained last week about the challenges of preaching on Mary and Martha. I'd happily trade her for Hosea. Hosea was a prophet in the 8th century BCE who strongly disagreed with Israel's alliance with Assyria, and saw it as a sign of unfaithfulness to the Lord. Now I'm just going to get it out there. The Lord was mad. Speaking through Hosea is very angry with Israel's unfaithfulness. So angry that the Lord compares Israel's behavior to that of a prostitute. And even instructs Hosea to take a prostitute as a wife. It's as if the Lord is asking his prophet to experience in his own life the pain that the Lord is experiencing when Israel turns to other allies and gods again and again and again. We have to be careful with this passage, because it has been used to denigrate women, and it has been used to justify abusers. That is not what it's about. Whether or not Hosea's relationship with Gomer was a real relationship or just a metaphor, the deeper message of this prophetic book is about Israel's unfaithfulness, not only through idolatry, but also through breaking the covenant established with God, including the Ten Commandments. listen to what Hosea says later on in the book, in chapter 4. Hear the word of the Lord, O people of Israel. For the Lord has an indictment against the inhabitants of the land. There is no faithfulness or loyalty, and no knowledge of God in the land. Swearing, lying, and murder, and stealing, and adultery break out. Bloodshed follows bloodshed. Therefore the land mourns, and all who live in it languish, together with the wild animals and the birds of the air. Even the fish of the sea are perishing. Those are complaints that could be raised against God's people in almost any time. When we turn away from God, putting anger, fear, violence, greed, injustice, or dishonesty in God's place, even the earth becomes a victim of our infidelity. Not to mention those who are on the margins of our society. Adultery, lying, murder, theft, bloodshed, those are not the fruits that grow when people are living in covenant with God, whether in our time or Hosea's. So in response to Israel's actions, the Lord gives Hosea's children frightening names. Jezreel, a symbol of the Lord's punishment of Israel, resulting in Israel's strength being broken. Lo Ruhamah, literally meaning no mercy, because God will no longer forgive. Lo Ami, meaning not my people. The people have done so much damage to their relationship with the Lord that the Lord is not even going to claim them as his people. A fate that they have brought on themselves through their own actions. At the end of verse 9 of this chapter, things are looking pretty bleak. And yet, in the very next verse, it says, the number of people of Israel shall be like the sand of the sea, which can neither be measured nor numbered. And in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, it shall be said to them, children of the living God. God loves God's people so much that even though they continue to do the wrong thing, God loves them anyway. Maybe roaring and raging like a lion at times, but ultimately forgiving and renewing the covenant. Not because of something they do, but because of who God is. The one who loves them steadfastly, no matter what. This week, I read a Facebook post from author Annie Lamott, lamenting all the terrible things and violence that are going on in the world. At the end of her lament, she concluded with this: what is true is that the world has always been this way. People have always been this way. Grace always bats last. It just does. And finally, when all is said and done, and the dust settles, which it does, love is sovereign here. Grace always bats last. In the final inning, when it looks like evil and violence and our own sinful natures are winning, God's grace will come up to bat and knock it out of the park. And you know how I know? Because of Jesus. In the midst of God's people breaking covenant and betraying God over and over, God did something new. Becoming incarnate in the Word made flesh, Jesus. Jesus taught his disciples about God and about how to live lives of love and self-sacrifice. Jesus not only modeled how to pray, but how to be in right relationship with God and with one's neighbors. In the midst of betrayal and violence and death, Jesus loved and forgave even those who turned against him. And then, in that bleak moment after the crucifixion and the burial, grace came up to bat once more, and Jesus was raised from the dead. God never gives up on us. And wouldn't it be great if we stepped up to the plate and did our part to keep covenant with God? A little less betraying and a little more forgiving. A little less blaming and a little more taking responsibility. A little less fear and a whole lot more love. Being the people who trust God and who God can trust. Things were pretty bad in Hosea's time. And in Jesus' time, and in our time too. But grace always bats last. It just does.